Hello, everyone. Narcissus is free and most here, and welcome to part two of the Cavum Septum Pellucidum, and could this be behind pathological narcissism? This is where I'll be explaining what the CSP is, what it does, and its relationship to psychiatric disorders. I'll be providing this information in a brief and simple manner so as not to bore or overwhelm you. Links for detailed and more comprehensive explanations will be in the description box below. To begin, the cavum septi pellucidi, or CSP, is a midline structure of the fetal brain formed by fluid separating the two leaves of the septum pellucidum. The term septum means wall or partition, and pellucidum means transparent. Additionally, the septum pellucidum is found most of the time as a single median structure that is shared by both lateral ventricles and is sometimes perforated, which has no pathological consequence. And for the purposes of this series, the cavum on the fetus, its size, and when it closes or doesn't close is what this series will be mainly focused on. The CSP is usually visible from 18 weeks until term gestation. That constitutes an important landmark in the evaluation of fetal brain anatomy. In normal fetuses, the CSP should always be visualized between 18 and 37 weeks, or with biparietal diameter, which is always between 44 and 88 millimeters. Failure to observe the CSP in this interval, or possibly the presence of a large CSP, may indicate abnormal cerebral development and would be a concern warranting further investigation. If the CSP persists after infancy, it has been linked to neural maldevelopment and mental disorders that are associated with decreased brain tissue, maladaptive psychological and behavioral traits, as well as psychopathy. Next, what happens if there is an enlarged or absent CSP? Well, this can be a sign of atypical brain development. For example, measuring the width of the CSP in ultrasound images can help diagnose something called deletion syndrome, where deletion syndromes are caused by missing parts of chromosomes which contain DNA and genes that determine how the body functions and looks. However, while the CSP's presence in adulthood is said to be uncommon, again, this has been linked to various psychiatric disorders. So, now we know that a cavum septum pellucidum will be present in the fetus and over 85% of them fused by 3 to 6 months of age, meaning that a CSP does persist in 15% of the adult population. And I found that really interesting and certainly piqued my curiosity. That said, what's the difference between the enlarged and persistent CSP? Well, an enlarged cavum would be a cavum that is longer than 6 millimeters in a fetus, while the persistent is a cavum that remains after infancy, and that's the one I'll be focusing on exclusively going forward. But know that both are considered abnormal variations in brain development and can be associated with neuropsychiatric disturbances. Furthermore, possible implications for the enlarged CSP could be hydrocephaly, chromosomal translocations, growth restriction, and for the persistent CSP, cerebral dysgenesis and neuropsychiatric disturbances. In the paper, according to the relationship between cavum septum pellucidum and psychopathic traits in a large forensic sample by Dana Crooks et al., they state that while it's clinical significance is non-specific, CSP is considered an abnormal variation and a marker for disrupted brain development, which I've already talked about. And according to this paper, several reports have indicated associations between CSP and a long list of psychologically and behaviorally relevant traits and conditions. These have included psychosis and schizophrenia, post-traumatic stress disorder, obsessive-compulsive disorder, bipolar and other mood disorders, substance abuse, a history of head trauma, and particularly relevant to this report, antisocial personality and psychopathic traits. And I'll be referring to this paper, as well as many others, in upcoming parts of the CSP video series. Finally, I'll leave you with a video on just how the CSP is measured by Dr. H. A. Venkatesh performing the ultrasound procedure on an infant with an enlarged CSP. Just a reminder, the CSP begins to close around 37 weeks in utero. By term, 97% of infants will have a complete posterior closure, and by 6 months old, 85% of infants will have completely obliterated CSP, which is exactly what should happen. However, what happens to the other 15%, researchers are just now beginning to uncover.
Obstetrical symptomism can start derived from the Latin word cavum septum, which has got three components. The cavum is nothing but anatomy. The septum is on either side of the anatomy. You've got fence, that is the septum. And the pericytum is a transparent area. That's why the name cavum septum pericytum. This has got an important role in the fetal scan. And the fetal ultrasound always look at cavum septum pericytum because it's going to give an impression about the being or the central four prime structures. And normally, the cavum septum pericytum appears after 13 to 14 weeks of gestation. And usually, it's almost seen in most of the babies after 18 weeks of gestation. Here I have a neonate who had the fetal ultrasound demonstrating the cavum septum pericytum measuring around more than 10 millimeters. And the same baby underwent postnatal scan at around 2 days age. The coronal view of the brain is done. The probe is kept in the anterior fontanel with the marker facing to the right, and you can appreciate the images on the screen here. This is the coronal view of the brain. You can appreciate the important structures here. This is the cavum septum pellucidum. And you see, this is the margin of the cavum septum pericytum. That's why I told you, septum is on either side of the cavity. This is a cavum. It's called cave of cavum septum pericytum. So this is the cave. This is the margin, that is septum. And it's very transparent area. That's why it's called cavum septum pericytum. You see, anteriorly, it is related to the gene of corpus callosum. This is the corpus callosum dressing, bounded by two hyperechogenic areas. And in the cell of the cavum septum pericytum, we have got frontal horns of the lateral ventricle. Posteriorly, it is related to pillars of the fornix. To demonstrate cavum septum pericytum on sagittal view of the brain, the probe is kept in the anterior fontanel with a marker facing the sky, and you can appreciate the images now on the screen here. The mid sagittal view of the same baby, where you appreciate, you can see that. There's a former shape structure here, and this is corpus callosum. And you see, this is the black area. Yeah, this is cavum septum pericytum, and this is the vertebrae. Anyway, I'm interested only with cavum septum pericytum here. This cavum septum pericytum, you see the relationship. This cavum septum pericytum is superiorly related to the body of the corpus callosum. This is the body of the corpus callosum. Inferiorly, it is related to rostrum of corpus callosum. And this cavum septum pericytum is filled with the cerebrospinal fluid. In the coronal view of the brain demonstrating the cavum septum pericytum, this is to measure the width of the cavum septum pericytum. If I measure from caudal, from anteroposterior, this will become the length, and I'm interested in the width of the cavum septum pericytum. This is the margin of cavum septum pericytum. Either side, I measure from here till here. This is called width of the cavum septum pericytum. I told you, normally the cavum septum pericytum is between 2 millimeter to 10 millimeter, but here you can see this is around 9.56 millimeter. The clinical importance of cavum septum pericytum, usually the cavum septum pericytum crosses by 3 months of age, postnatal age, up to 6 months of postnatal age. There are three important scenarios. One is the persistence of cavum septum pericytum. Second thing is that is beyond the usual closure period, that is beyond 6 months of age. Second thing is the enlarged cavum septum. Third is the absence of cavum septum pericytum. Now, as I was talking to you, that corpus callosum and cavum septum pericytum are closely related. Because the closeness The absence of corpus callosum also causes the absence of nerves in the brazil of the penis. The absence of nerves in the brazil is related to absence of corpus callosum in one part. The second thing, there are two other important clinical conditions. One is called holoporous epidemia. The second is septo-optic dysplasia. So, corpus callosum agents, septo-optic dysplasia, holoporous epidemia. These are the important clinical conditions here you see the absence of games of the peripheral. This is very, very important for the fetal ultrasonologist to look for this important image on ultrasound training in the penis. The binding or enlarged nerves of temporalism may also be associated with sometimes bad ovulation, right? And because this nerves of temporalism is related to limbic structure, it is also concerned with behavior and emotions. So, really, some psychiatric conditions are related to which of life actually matters here in temporalism is. Thank you so much for listening a brief note on the claims of temperature. So, in the election, claims of temperature is very important for the fetal ultrasonologist to define the normal morphology of the whole brain of it.